Cork Tip is huge. I mean, Cork Tip is kind of the ancient rivalry. Everybody seems to have a rivalry with Tip, because Tip have so many borders. Tip border more hurling counties than anybody else. But Cork Tip, I suppose, was the mainstay of the Munster Championship for decades.
They're fantastic matches, they're fantastic occasions. You're in Cork for the Tip Cork match. There's just a bit of excitement about it. That's not to say that other rivalries don't have the same, but we'd like to think that Tip Cork has something, I suppose, that's been developed over time, and it's great to be part of it, and we enjoy it, particularly when we beat them.
It's helped by the fact that the Tipperary motto is the Hay saved and Cork bet. And grave offence, when I was a child, grave offence was taken at the appearance of that motto. So they set themselves up really for it.
High summer begins on a Sunday in June. In Páirc Uí Chaoimh, hard by the Lee, the natives of Cork and Tipperary squeeze in to watch their hurlers make war. The stakes are high. For the winners, there is a place in the Munster hurling final. For the losers, weeks of teary-eyed post-mortem. Cork and Tipperary is more than a match, more than a defining rivalry. It is the expression of a tribal tension which goes back centuries.
You sort of measure yourself against Tipperary. I mean, playing well against other counties is fine, but you know, you really only played well when you played well against Tipperary.
The origins of this rivalry are undocumented, but records show thrilling clashes between the counties as far back as 1886, just 2 years after the founding of the GAA.
That suggests that even before the GAA was founded, that there was something between Tip and Cork, because if there was such respect for a visit of five Tipperary teams 2 years after the foundation of the GAA, it didn't come out of nothing. It had to have some kind of ancestry, and obviously it existed before the GAA.
Over the intervening years, the counties have met 76 times, each game another line added to myth and lore.
We salute the champion, Mick Ryan, Tommy Doyle, Tommy Ryan, Mick Byrne, Captain Pat Stakelum, and former hurling star. And now,
from my own personal point of view, listening to my parents and people of that era, 49, 50, 51, Tip won three in a row, and then Cork won three in a row, and the Christy Ring, John Doyle thing, both with eight All Ireland medals. I suppose, obviously, over time, Tip Cork has been the enduring rivalry in certainly Munster hurling, if not Irish hurling.
For people like Michael Cleary, being born and raised into a traditional, strong hurling county meant a different sort of childhood.
You're often asked the question, when did you start hurling, or what age did you start hurling? I think nobody can answer that question, because as soon as you can walk in Tipperary or Cork, Kilkenny, or in a hurling county, you're given a hurley.
Yes, in Kilkenny there's always been a tradition, hurling every day of the week. Every hour you get your hands on a hurl, you go out, you hit the ball against the wall, you go out and play with your brothers. You go to the hurling field really 7 days a week, 7 nights a week, whenever.
Growing up in Kilkenny, you would certainly be aware of the tradition. I mean, hurling is something that is spoken about morning, noon and night. I suppose lifestyles have changed a little bit now. You had people maybe going to the creamery, to the post office, and the conversation most Monday mornings was about the games the previous weekend. Maybe it takes place in other locations now, in offices and whatnot. So you were very much aware. The radio was perhaps the local source of games and what was happening on the national front. But you were certainly very well aware of the heroes of the day, and particularly relating to your own county.
If there is such a thing as a hurling heartland, its notional borders encompass Cork, Tipperary and Kilkenny. Historians have put forward several theories explaining the concentration of the game's blue bloods in these parts.
One theory is that the broad fields of Tipperary were conducive to the game, a good supply of ash for making of hurley sticks. I suppose the same can be said about Kilkenny and Cork. The reason for the strength of it in Kilkenny and up along the Shore Valley was because the Normans came up along that way, and that they adopted the team, brought their organisational ability and so on. The game developed any place where there was a Norman presence, developed in a way that it didn't develop in other places.
By the 17th century, Irish landlords had become interested in the pastimes of the peasant tenantry, particularly as the games offered chances for wagering. Estates like Baron Purcell's of Lochmore, Tipperary, retained professional teams for their own amusement and organised matches with aristocratic neighbours.
They brought to the game an order and a regulation, and some say even that these same landlords, that they established a team organisation.
But social and political upheavals caused landlords to withdraw their patronage of peasant games. And by the 19th century, hurling had fallen into decline. Other ball games, like cricket, rose in popularity. And it took a phenomenon like the newly founded GAA to bring hurling back to prominence.
In 1860, for instance, there were something in the region of 60 cricket clubs in Tipperary, and similarly in Kilkenny there were a lot of cricket clubs, and they were stick games. And when hurling had declined from its glorious period in the 18th century, they had taken to cricket, but they still continued playing a stick game. So when the GAA was revived, they had the tradition of striking with a stick, and it was easy to revive the skills of hurling then.
Something about the intensity of championship hurling sets Irish pulses racing. The national imagination is enthralled not just to the giants of summer, but to the rhythms of the game at parish and club level.
There's a great sense of identity, comradeship. You play with the people who you've grown up with, your neighbours, and the rivalries are created, I suppose, firstly by playing your next door neighbours, then by county versus county.
Being local is crucial. You know, it's based on the parish system, clubs are based on the parish system, and the fact that the players live in the community and work in the community, so everybody has some sort of connection. You know, they played with them at underage level, or they see them in the street, or some people work with them, and it's crucial in terms of generating that interest and, you know, an identity and a sense of following. When you start to play, when you're a kid, it's about playing for Cork. Initially you just imagine yourself playing, you know, you're one of the Cork players or whatever, and then as you get a bit older, maybe into your teens, you kind of hope that you would play for Cork. I suppose the best way of explaining it is to look at it now. If I was to go back now, knowing what I know, and you offered me one thing, you know, you get one wish, it would be still to play for Cork. So playing in an All-Ireland final was nearly a bonus. You know, it was just that you were playing for Cork. And I think the fact that hurling is so important in Cork means that when you play in an All-Ireland final, it's a bit arrogant, but you're following in the steps of people who've won, so you nearly think you're automatically going to win.
Winning may be something which Cork hurlers expect of themselves, but the game needs more than its aristocracy, if it is to survive, however. The most fondly remembered eras in the game involve upstart insurrections, breakouts by traditionally oppressed counties. None more beloved than the great Wexford team of the 1950s, the men who deprived Christy Ring of his ninth All-Ireland medal.
But within 30 seconds of the start, Tim Flood got the first Wexford point, and soon the Slaney men were back for more.
I remember so clearly in 56, when Wexford beat Cork, and Ring was running for his ninth medal, and Wexford won it.
Then Martin Codd,
at the end of the game, when players usually celebrate themselves, you know, Ring was playing it full forward for Cork.
21 yards free. Who else but Christy Ring? He lifts his strikes and it's in the net. Cork.
And Bobby Racker was playing it right full back on him. And the great Both of them great. Nick O'Donnell, the great fullback.
And there it is. And as the final whistle blows,
lifted him on their shoulders with the help of Art Foley, the goalkeeper, honouring their opponent who had lost. Instead of celebrating themselves, they thought of their opponent. That, in my opinion, that was my greatest experience of sportsmanship on any field of play.
Wexford's golden era grows more distant by the year. Their misfortune is to be neighbours to the game's most dominant force, Kilkenny.
Kilkenny led by Seamus Clear, Ollie Walsh, Sean Clossy, Paddy Morden, Tracy...
Well, if you're growing up in a place like Kilkenny, I suppose you start to dream, could I be there one day representing the county? I suppose particularly in Croke Park. There's very few people who come up in Kilkenny who don't have that dream. And if you have a tradition of hurling in the family, it probably makes it even a little stronger and puts maybe added pressure on young people. But there's a lot of attention played in the schools, in the clubs, moving on to the secondary schools and colleges. And that sets up people for the opportunity.
From the throw-in, Mick Brophy...
Hurling has changed a lot. The style of hurling, the training, the skill level has certainly improved. The equipment is better, better hurley sticks, pitches are much better. So a lot about hurling has certainly improved. But back in those days, you still had to train hard. You didn't have the luxury of going to a gym over the winter time. You certainly went out into the local field and you mucked out there in all sorts of weather. So it was a different environment.
Hurling is in the bloodstream in a place like Kilkenny. The most successful county in the game's history, Kilkenny have been All-Ireland champions 31 times and provincial champions 65 times. That success is founded on a culture of hurling within the county, which ensures almost equal dominance down through the grades. A level of achievement which regenerates itself among each successive generation.
I never saw myself playing for Kilkenny at senior level, but luckily enough, I got the call up around 1980. And the second year we won the All-Ireland, which was 1982, and Brian Cody, the present manager, was captain, and I was captain in 1983, which we won again. Standing in Croke Park on All-Ireland final day is an unbelievable experience, and the two things that I remember really was running out on the field, the atmosphere and the buzz, and all of a sudden you're out there in the cauldron of spectators. And that time we stood in our position, so you were really standing with your opponent and you were both standing silent, and you knew for the next 70 minutes there was going to be no silence in that position. So, yeah, it would be a big memory for me.
And the game is on!
The fortnight before the All-Ireland final is the best fortnight of your life because everyone is slapping you on the back and everyone is on a high in the county, and it's over. Okay, to go up and get the cup is really fabulous, but then once that's done and once you go back to your hotel and have your 1 or 2 days enjoyment, reality steps in then again.
Joins his brother Joe.
In general, when it's over, all of a sudden there's a void in your life, but still, I wouldn't change it for anything.
Favourites Tipperary are led by Matt Hassett, Mick Burns.
Kilkenny's dominance is no accident. The county has learned the lessons of history. Just across the border, for instance, Tipperary spent the 50s and 60s gorging on titles. Then it ended.
You're talking an era in the early mid 70s. Tipperary were on the back of, I suppose, their best ever decade, the 60s, where they won 4 All-Irelands in 5 years and contested another 2 or 3 finals. Had won in 71, lost a Munster final in 73, and here they were, went 10 years without winning a single championship match. For me growing up and all my peers that would have been into the hurling, and we were very envious of Cork, Limerick, Kilkenny or whatever. We were living in a period where you were being told Tip were still as good as the rest, but yet you got one game a year to see it, so it was some great fun following Tip in the 70s now.
Let's have some more, says Jimmy Dawson.
Tipperary's famine of the 1970s was made more painful by memories of the era which preceded it. 2 decades of championship glory where a series of legends were bequeathed to the game.
And during that great period, say from 49 to 68, a period of 19 championships, Tipperary got to the All-Ireland, qualified for the All-Ireland on 10 occasions, and won 8. they produced a set of players, particularly forwards, that were the best probably Tipperary ever had.
It's Tipperary again, it's Jimmy Doyle again.
Jimmy Doyle would be regarded as one of the greatest players that Tipperary ever produced. And his personal tally of All-Irelands is tremendous. He played in 13 All-Irelands. We achieved so much and we had so much talent during that period, an enormous amount of talent.
To assist his midfield colleague, Kieran Farr, trying to pick it up and runs on to John Kennedy.
Talent can't be taken for granted, however. After 1971, it would take 18 years before Tipperary would experience success again. By then, the county panel was filled by players like Michael Cleary, who had grown up in an era of famine.
I was lucky enough to play a county minor at 17, and then fortunate enough to get playing with Tipperary when it was 2021, and had 10 great years. I would have to say I always felt it an honour to play with my club, and even more so with my county. It's like you've achieved something if you play with Tipperary. To me, it's more than a game. It is kind of an art form. It's a way of life for people to play it. I don't think there's anything pulls a parish or a county together like your team getting ready for a big match or getting a run in the championship or whatever. It's the X factor. It's just it hits the spot with everybody, men, women.
The big three, Kilkenny, Tip and Cork, have shaped the history of championship hurling. But it's the periods of relief from their dominance which keep the game alive. The 1990s were a time of revolution.
It was Dooley who took the free, a low enough trajectory, batted out.
They say the big three, Cork, Kilkenny, Tipperary, had won. They'd never gone more than 2 years without winning an All-Ireland in the history of the GAA, you know, over 100 years. So then you had Clare, Wexford, Limerick, and you had a real kind of a democratic championship where you had, you know, there was a bit of mystery about it.
Among the principal agents of change in the 90s was the great Clare team, who shrugged off decades of failure to seize a place at hurling's top table, changing your thinking about the game as they did so.
It was a coincidence of outstanding leadership in terms of Loughnane, McNamara, Considine, and also outstanding players and fantastic leaders on the field whose mentality was kind of symbiotic with what Loughnane was trying to achieve. Clare made themselves into winners. What they did was they changed the whole landscape. The way that they trained was different, very much into physical endurance, physical sacrifice, and that was a means of building up their mentality. Other teams then copied it.
Wexford would also be part of the new hurling order emerging into the light, just a year after Clare's breakthrough.
Well, Wexford certainly would have looked very hard at the Clare template. I mean, they trained exceptionally hard under Liam Griffin the year they won the All-Ireland in 96. Now, Liam was an exceptional guy. You had a coincidence of great leadership with a good set of players. I mean, but those players had been losing for years.
Larry Murphy's in there challenging Tom Dempsey's role.
He brought in a sports psychologist, Niamh Fitzpatrick, who was kind of a silent member of that, you know, or a secret member of their team that year. But she was hugely influential. And the players were prepared to do anything. Offaly were a unique group with a different outlook. Offaly were tremendously gifted hurlers. They played a really beautiful game. If you go through that decade, most of the best games involved Offaly because they didn't buy into the physical endurance, the gym stuff. But yet they won two All-Irelands in the most competitive decade in the history of hurling. So what they did was different and it added something to the mix.
After the novelty of the revolution years, hurling waited for the response of the aristocracy. It would be emphatic. Kilkenny, Cork, and to a lesser extent Tip, have dominated the game in recent years.
Champions for the 27th.
What we really need is mystery in the championship. We really need to know. We really need three or four teams with a serious chance of winning a Munster final, a serious chance of winning a Leinster final, and we don't have that. We have a competitive Munster championship, and a completely meaningless at this stage Leinster championship.
The 90s would be short-lived. The spectacle of three or four teams challenging the traditional powers would give way to a return to old structures. Does the game have a serious chance of broadening its base?
There is one final shot at it now. And I think that whatever emerges now, I think will have to be left for about 5 years. But realistically, the overall number of teams is really not much different than when I was playing. Change a couple of counties here and there, yes, but overall it's not any great different.
The colour and vibrancy of a championship summer often disguises the deeper problems besetting the game. Does the dominance of three teams offer the game an exciting future, or condemn hurling to repeat its own history over and over? By the meeting of Cork and Tipperary at the height of a championship summer, might be the hottest ticket in Irish sport. The box office doesn't often feel the heat in other parts of the hurling nation. The game has different meanings elsewhere.
Hurling in Ulster is probably down the pecking order. I mean, I think it goes without saying. I mean, the thing to do in Ulster is to play football, because it seems to be the image game. We went through the period of time where if you were walking the street with a hurl, then the British soldiers stopped you as having an offensive weapon, and sort of then the usual rigmarole and hassle erupted. But I mean, obviously they don't know the spirit of Irish people, and that's one of the things why they'll never defeat us. They can invade us, but they can never defeat us. And they can't grasp that concept, that we have something unique here in hurling, and that hurling is an identity to us. It's a badge of honour, if you want to sort of put it another way.
The onset of the troubles in the six counties made the cultivation of Ulster hurling troublesome. But in the glens of Antrim and parts of Down, Derry and Armagh, the game is part of the local identity.
You go back to the days whenever the Catholics were put in places like South Armagh and North Antrim, like where the farming land was very poor, as I'm sure you can see, you're standing here and there's mountains everywhere. And that there, because back to that, it was a national, and it still is a national sport, and it was a form of our identity, which hurling means to us. In nationalist area, that's what you do, you play Gaelic games.
For the hurlers of Antrim, this fierce love, which hardly dared speak its name through the bad times, flowered into the unforgettable summer of 1989, when a side managed by Jim Nelson reached the All-Ireland final to play the mighty Tipperary.
Well, the 89 team had quite a few qualities. One of the qualities that they had is that they were a very committed bunch of players, and whenever those players were brought together, they also had a great desire to do well. They wanted to be better than what they were. The other thing that they did have, which maybe the present team maybe wouldn't have in abundance, is that they had a great physical presence, and that team could never be intimidated. And when you have that sort of attitude and that sort of backup, I mean, like, you go into games and you've a good start. And I mean, like, I know whenever we played the Tipperarys and the Corks and the Kilkennys and all these here, I mean, like, it wasn't always that we were going hoping. We were more going and playing to say, we think we can get a result here.
As Antrim bid for a little bit more shape in their side, but it's Declan...
Despite the wave of excitement which swept Antrim from Belfast to the Glens, a win over a hungry Tip side in 1989 was too much to hope for. Gradually, since then, the county team drifted in the rankings. Antrim's physical remove from the hurling strongholds of Leinster and Munster has made life difficult. The solution from 2009 would be to tamper with geography and history and to place Antrim into Leinster. Would that be enough?
we definitely struggle with geography. Geography has always hampered us, but thankfully now the M1 is good roads now. It's getting shorter all the time. The reality is, we're only picking from three or four clubs. We're Cork of over 200, maybe, you know, realistically. And it's a standard, and it's like if we have players that aren't committed, you kind of have to put up with them because that's what you have, and you can't throw them over. Brian Cody has the luxury of throwing a few out and pulling a few more in, and every bit is good. We wouldn't have that luxury. Like, we kind of have to cut the cloth to suit ourselves, like, you know.
The nature of the game of hurling is such that there are no shortcuts when it comes to cultivating the game. Ulster Hurling has worked hard at tending its grassroots and nourishing the game at the juvenile level, but still feels neglected and overlooked at times.
There's a responsibility on, first of all, Croke Park to merchandise and promote the game, which they do, but they need to be better. There's a responsibility on counties and on provinces, and particularly the province of Ulster, that if football is the dominant game in Ulster, then we should be trying to bring hurling up to the same level and have the same participation and the same interest in it. And that requires time and attention again. It requires an input from the Ulster Council, not just... and I don't want to sort of be negative in the sense that it's only Ulster Council's fault. It's all our faults. It's my fault as well as everybody else's. So if I'm doing something about it, then I expect other people to do something about it as well. Hurling goes back centuries here, and we can trace it back. So it shouldn't be put on the back burner, and it shouldn't be ignored as an inconvenience for some county boards, which it is, that another to foster the football will put the hurling on the back burner. That's not good enough. It needs to change, and the attitudes need to change.
Hurling's contribution to our national culture surprises and intrigues visitors to the country. If hurling still courses through our national conversation, the pulse is provided by the continual emergence of new stars, who we hold against the sun for comparison with the great legends of the game. 4 minutes
into the second half. I think we come out of a culture where you're expected to be self-effacing and you're not supposed to be proud of yourself or strong or assertive. So teams do that for you. You know, when I grew up in the 60s, for instance, this was still a very subservient mentality in the country. Authority was deferred to far too much. But your hurlers or your footballers, I suppose, in footballing places, they did that for you. They asserted themselves, so you asserted yourself through them. So it was a kind of a safe form of assertion, and that, I suppose, it acted as a kind of social relief valve in that sense. Now that people have become much more properly assertive in themselves, they tend to admire more the art of the game, or the skill, or the elan, the sheer vitality of it. And I think that's probably a good thing. For us, it was more primitive. It was, our lad is bigger than, stronger than, and faster than your lad, so the hell with you.
Every generation has had its superstar hurlers, but the enduring icons of the game are few.
I don't think there's anyone anywhere who was ever as skillful as Ring. He was, in my opinion, the supreme hurler in all aspects of the game: skill, courage, strength, and everything.
Up along the left wing, his stick is blocked down, but he palms it over, and it's a point. With the stick or with the hand, it's all the same.
He said one time in an interview that he always tried to achieve the impossible. He didn't claim he achieved the impossible, but that tells what his attitude and his mindset was in the game.
When Ring, to me, was as remote and as godly as Cú Chulainn. And, you know, I'd say to give him Cú Chulainn a run for his money as well, with the shoulders on him and that implacable will I think what I loved about Ring, and he was coming to the end of his career when I used to see him play, was the willpower, absolute concentration. Everything I lacked, everything that made me never a hurler, he had it, kind of that mindset that there was nothing except scoring. And anybody got in his way, God help him. We used to love hearing the stories, and it was in later years you heard more of them, of course, of all the fellas who played on Ring and how they dreaded it.
The inspiration passed down through the ages finds a welcome wherever it lands. The Farrell sisters in Thomastown, County Kilkenny, are part of a new wave of rising camogie stars. The house has already welcomed home a dozen All-Ireland medals.
My mum trains the team, so I always was at trainings, and I just loved it more because when all the girls started as well, because something we could do together anyway. I'm under 18 this year for the club and senior, and then I'm on the under 18 county team and the intermediate senior county team, so that's tough enough now.
Anna is just in the vanguard of the Farrell sisters' assault on the camogie world. Her next two sisters, Shelley and Megan, wear the same colours at county, club and school level. Younger sister Eimear is already starting with the club's under 8s.
I used to play it when I was younger all the time, and I had a great interest in it, and I love it. And Martin, my husband, plays it. He used to play hurling, so he loved that end of it. So I suppose they grew up with it. And we used to be out here in the garden hurling, and they learned to get a love of it through that.
In the garden, we kind of pass it to each other and get each other into the game.
Started this new thing of trying to flick it over people's heads, and it always started out in the garden trying to flick it over each other's heads, and everything that we try in matches usually starts up there, and out there we just kind of have a little game between us, so it gets kind of competitive sometimes anyway. But like sometimes now some people would have to go in crying, and poor Eimear gets a raw deal out there sometimes.
Come on,
The time-honoured ritual of informal practice is just one of the girls' weekly training load. The club requires 2 nights a week. The county and school have demands on top of that.
They love it, and I loved it. And we coach under 8s, under 12s, under 16s, under 18s.
The game demands more and more, though. Every chance to practice and play is seized, even if that means the odd broken window, or diversions into the world of rock climbing.
Out in the yard then was just drills, first touch, everything.
First touch against the wall, and then, because you don't know where it's going to go, because it hits off one part of the wall and goes the other direction, so it's really touch.
Just reflexes, and that's like everything, really.
Dedication to the game is rewarded by success. The girls' trophy collection grows by the month. But this year, their All-Ireland win with their school, St. Bridget's of Callan, was something a little bit special.
That was best year of our lives now, so far in hurling, because it just means so much for the school, because they told us, you're not going to win this every year, you might not even get the chance to win it. So it was just brilliant winning it with all the girls, because in the school with them for 4 years, it's like your family, so it was just brilliant.
Trying to engineer a score, Liz Dunphy watches it go by to Angela Downey.
Camogie players may practice the same skills as their hurling brothers, but again, like Ulster hurling, the media spotlight seldom shines in these places. Despite the odd breakthrough star like Angela Downey, the game struggles for attention. Can more be done to highlight the game and bring its wonders to more of the Farrell sisters' generation?
They have a very good sponsors, the National Camogie Association, but I would try and get more sponsorship. I would try and get more promotional involvements, more ads, maybe more different. Get the younger camogie players that play on the county teams, get them known more, and then that will portray itself down through the rest of the ranks. In the last 6 months, they have appointed a lot of directors of camogie in the different Munster, Leinster, in the different areas, and they're all younger people, and they seem to be doing an excellent job now. And if they can keep going along that way, it will help them enormously, because they're all players that have already played and they seem to know what they're talking about, and they seem to promote a good ethos in camogie. So yes, I think that's the way to go.
With over a century of history under its belt, camogie has come to a crossroads. The game is deprived of the attention given to hurling, but offers the same joys to those that play it. That may have to be enough.
It's a huge part of our lives anyway. Actually a huge part of Kilkenny as a county. Camogie is very important. Everybody loves playing it. It's a way of life here in Kilkenny. And they're fortunate in that the girls have been lucky. They've been winning coming along. So, you know, maybe in a few years' time we'll have a senior county All-Ireland for Kilkenny. You never know, but it's very much part of our lives here.
Despite its perennial blossoming, there's a media cottage industry in predicting the decline of hurling. The game is hardy and well-rooted, but does its failure to spread these roots threaten its future?
Hurling needs Limerick to win All-Irelands. It needs Clare, it needs Waterford, it needs Laois, Dublin, Wexford, Offaly. They need these counties to be strong all the time. And I think rather than trying to, even though it's a small, small country, personally I think they should try promote the game and make it strong in the counties where it has a foothold and develop it there.
I think the game is capable of being expanded, but it's going to take a huge amount of work. It's a real long-term project. There's the issue of underage success, but there's also the issue of values. It comes down to values. It comes down to the fact that when, you know, a number of decades ago when I was starting first, I wanted to play hurling because my heroes were playing hurling. You know, if you're in a football county, your heroes are playing football. I don't think it's anything to do with the DNA. It's basically what's valued in the county. And that's a long process. You have to keep working, hope you get a breakthrough, and then hope that you can build on it. But it's going to take years, decades.
Tell the boy which way you're going first.
One man charged with the task of evangelising the game in every corner of the country is National Hurling Coordinator Paddy Butler.
Put it very simply, my single mission is to ensure that every child in Ireland, by the fact that they're Irish, get a chance to play hurling when they're small. And they can make their own choices later on. But if they don't get the choice early on, they have no choice. So a lot of children are denied the choice to hurl, even though they're Irish citizens. It looks to me that the skill level of any sport is commensurate with the level of coaching. So if we can improve the level of coaching, we automatically improve the level of skill in the players. Make sure hurling is done in schools, make sure hurling is done in clubs, GAA clubs. Some GAA clubs aren't as careful as they might be. And make sure hurling is done at summer camps, make sure every opportunity is there in the system that hurling is looked after and not shoved aside. We take a case like Mayo, where they have 100% increase in participation in 5 years. You know, I mean, I'm not saying they're going to win the McCarthy Cup now in a couple of years, but if they maintain that, then they will certainly come to a standard. You know, they will satisfy themselves, and it will be very important for young boys in Mayo to want to play for Mayo. And that would be a ground shift. So at the moment, we have an elite group of young people there from the hurling tradition areas like Turin and places like that who want to hurl, but we want to scatter that into bigger urban areas where there's a huge population.
So far, so good.
Of all the places where hurling is being grown and nurtured, Dublin is perhaps key. Here in the rugby heartland of Southside Dublin, Kilmacud Crokes have devoted huge resources to developing their young sides with a view to the future.
I suppose the most recent development, recent being in the last 3 or 4 years, is we've increased the number of times we train them, where we have them out on the hurling pitch from possibly once a week, possibly even less than once a week, to 3 times a week, certainly twice, and maybe a match at the weekend as well. I suppose the most important thing is we've refocused the hurling year from being a spring type situation where lads play through the school year and then finish up at the start of the summer. We're hurling now in the better weather for hurling. I suppose that's probably the most the biggest change, along with the number of times that we'd actually play and have the kids out training in any given week.
Kilmacud Crokes have looked beyond their own county borders in their efforts to improve standards. And a regular schedule of challenge games with clubs in more traditional hurling counties has become part of their routine.
You're playing against the higher standard players. It's, you know, it makes sense at any sport to pitch yourself against the best or against the strongest, and that's really what we're doing, and the lads are certainly benefiting from that. You know, it doesn't take Einstein to work out that Kilkenny, Cork, Tipperary, the strong hurling counties are the ones that seem to be doing it right. They're winning the All-Irelands, and that's ultimately what we want to be doing, both at juvenile level and obviously up to senior level. So, you know, we really feel that, I suppose, imitation is the best form of flattery.
The commitment of a broad range of people in Kilmacud has brought results so far, with the club achieving notable underage success, including a national Fáil na Gael title. Ultimately, though, what is the aspiration?
Oh, to win national titles at club level. No question. To win All-Ireland senior championships with the club. And that to feed on to Dublin winning All-Irelands. But, you know, that's what we're here for. That's what I'm here for. It's great, and don't, you know, it's obviously fantastic for under-11s, under-12s, all the young teams to play, and for all kids to play sport. The step up from that is for them to be competitive at the sport. But, you know, there's a lot of time and a lot of work, and it's a serious matter behind the scenes, you know. Ultimately, in 10 years' time, there's an under-11s there behind us training, and I would hope that a number of them are playing on our senior hurling team here, and maybe a couple of them are on the Dublin senior hurling team, and seriously challenging for All-Ireland honours. We make no apologies for that whatsoever.
The rise of clubs like Kilmacud Crokes has been aided by the systematic investment of funds into hurling by the Dublin County Board. Michael Connolly was one of the first and most influential hurling development officers to be appointed by the board back in 2003.
When I arrived, I found there was a huge amount of hurling activity, and there was a huge kind of goodwill and appetite for the kind of volunteer work, the volunteer workload that was going to maybe bring Dublin a step or two forward. The major gap that we found was the fact that the county board wasn't systematically intervening to raise standards. I mean, there is an awful lot of hurling played in Dublin, and maybe people from rural backgrounds like myself would not have been as aware of that. So we found like we probably had enough of activity, and the focus had to be on standards development at the start. You have to be able to stand back and look at what you can do to build some sort of a structure or a system. And I mean, that is one of maybe, I wouldn't say the failings in the GAA, it's one of the things that we're only beginning to learn how to do, how to systematically develop the games. The first thing we looked at was standards, and we put in a regionalised development squad system around the county. Now, this had existed already, but it wasn't regionalised. It didn't have as many people engaged, and we set up a back office system to take away as much of the, how would you say, as much of the hassle that a volunteer of that constable with that level of coaching ability would have to complete in their clubs. And catch on the run.
I've been with Kilmacud Crokes for the last maybe 3 years, and I suppose my role will be to assist the volunteer effort we made here in the club. Basically, that would mean helping out with club mentors, club coaches within the club, trying to upskill them as well as the children playing in the club. One of my main areas of responsibility would be coaching in the local primary schools. We'd have maybe about 10 primary schools that would be a feeder of Kilmacud Crokes, and I'd coach within the school year in them school teams. Coaching up the first to third class. Also, in terms of working with the club, it provide coach education workshops, like the level one coaching course, the foundation coaching course for coaches. I suppose my job is not to replace the volunteer effort being made, but to help mentors, coaches upskill themselves, as well as upskill the children playing hurling.
Enabling clubs to systematically benefit from resources and expertise has brought Dublin a welcome amount of success at underage level. Does Dublin provide a template for the survival of the game at a broader level?
I think, myself personally, that there, you have to look at games development in the GAA in three contexts. One is large urban areas, and then you've got to look at it in another context, which is large provincial towns, and then you've got rural parishes. Now, you could probably separate them into a few different categories. We have to find a way that reinforces club activity in those three categories. And I think the way it has been done in Dublin is fairly successful, and I think that could be definitely replicated in the larger urban areas. It's probably a slightly different system for large provincial towns, and it's definitely not a one-size-fits-all for rural areas.
Dublin have painstakingly, for the last 15, 20 years, maintained a fantastic flow of development squads. And, you know, they've made a long-term investment. They realised that there was no short-term solution to this. If they're going to be competitive, if they're going to produce a team, they have to start at the very bottom and be patient and have the nerve to keep at it, keep at it, keep at it. I mean, there is a huge responsibility on every county to look after themselves, to put the structures in place like Dublin have. And I believe Dublin will get the rewards in the next 5 years, and Dublin, I think, will be the biggest challenge to Kilkenny over the next 5 years, biggest challengers. And their example is there to be followed.
With participation increasing in Dublin and throughout the country, Hurling's biggest challenge may be in supplying players with their precious ash wands. The Dowlings have been making hurleys in a small workshop in Kilkenny since the 1960s. The business was started by Raimi Dowling. His son Brian and grandsons now continue the family tradition. That tradition may now be under threat from other technologies.
I suppose there will be change, and if the graphite hurley is to be a success, I suppose, it means they'll have to start with the kids. So if they were able to corner that part of the market, that definitely it would have to come on stream. It depends on how the timber that is meant to be harvested or hoped to be harvested in about 10 years' time. If that's of a good quality, it may delay it a bit longer. If it's not of a good quality, it may fast forward it. But it's like everything, to say golf sticks changed from to the graphite, tennis rackets, fishing rods, so I suppose, why not? They'd be traditional games in themselves, in their own right. The history now is here so long that you'd be hoping that it would keep going, you know. Whether it will or not remains to be seen.
The next decade may herald the beginning of the end for the Ash Hurley. But it remains to be seen how the broader health of the game will fare in this time of competing distractions. In an era when the nature of Ireland and Irishness is changing so rapidly, hurling, a game so long linked to the nation's soul, may struggle not to become a casualty of change.
Ultimately, it's about people saying, look, this is part of our national culture. It's part of our national identity. And we all have a duty to try and keep fostering it and pass it on to the next generation.
To people like Lens, it's like having a relationship. You know, it's like having a marriage, it's like good days and bad days and rocky days. But it's something that you do. It's something that just is part of you. It's not something that you consciously make a decision, I think I will follow. And it's something that it just grows in around you. And even if you wanted to walk away from it, I don't feel you could.
I think what hurling says about the Irish psyche is that, you know, we like that sort of bedlam. We like the constant action.
I know certainly as kids growing up, we had the sense that it was only us, only we Irish played this game. And even though you never thought about it, it was at the back of your mind that this was a badge of distinction, a badge of identity.
I wanted to see Kerry and Dublin in every All-Ireland final just because I wanted to see who was the best.
These were the men who were going to win the All-Ireland every year. These were the men that were going to be playing in Croke Park in the big days, and all we could do was look on the sidelines and watch them. And unfortunately, a few days we took a bit of a hammering from them.